last Sunday, we were studying that verse, which refers to the argument as a marvel, Australia. That's a great verse coming first in the Protopanishad, and now in the Vedas. Ashtadhyaya is used in the connection. Ashtadhyavat pashti kashtadhyayam. Ashtadhyavat padavi tathayva chanyama. Ashtadhyavat anya shunodhi shutvavkenam vedana shayka kashtit. This is verse 29. Even in physical science, when you look at a small living cell, to the scientist is a marvel, a marvel of their construction, a marvel of organic activity within itself, creating, destroying, shaping, multiplying, is a marvel. Even the science of physics is a marvel to see that a tiny piece of matter can contain enormous energy. That is nuclear science. Ashtarya, Pashtarya, you can say that, also. It's all a wonder. When you go deep into nature, the wonder that you see outside becomes less. Greater wonders become revealed. Similarly, looking at man, that's why we have just started in the West. And they have also started to marvel at this wonderful piece. Shakespeare has expressed it, how wonderful a thing is man, in a famous passage. This man can control his world, he can understand it, he can transcend it, but if there's something in him which is such a marvel, last week I referred to the term coined by Robert Browning, British poet, the imprisoned splendor. A wonderful splendor is somewhere imprisoned within the body of man. That's called Ashtarya. Today, when physics, modern science, in its psychology, neurology, etc., will probe deeper and deeper into man, this marvel will increase more and more. The study of the brain itself is a tremendous marvel. How the brain operates, how the various cells work together and then produce a coherent life and reaction to the world. All this is subject of marvel. But the most marvelous is what the Manishas is dealing with, the infinite Atman. Behind this body-mind complex, which is so tiny, which is so contracted, and organism compared to the world outside. So within that is something tremendous. That is the biggest challenge for modern thought. Indian thought created long, long ago. That's what you find expressed in the verses. Ashtarya Vata Pashyati Kashtadhyaya. Ramakrishna used to say, Shiva, realizing his own infinite Shiva nature, could control himself and start dancing. Generally, you dance when you overflow in energy, then only you dance. If you are weak in energy, you will never dance. When expansion of energy within you, you dance. Shiva danced, is the result of that. He himself is amazed to see the Shiva energy within himself. He is Shiva, he is the one. So these are beautiful ideas coming out of this. From the discovery of the self of man, the marvelous reality that is there. Today, under the age, no books, no science, no scriptures can describe the glory of that reality that appears as a self in man. It's a remarkable reality. So, in one verse, the Gita has compressed this idea of marvel with the human mind experiences when it gets a glimpse of that infinite behind the creature made human individual. Normally we are a creature made human individual with very limited powers. But we suspect there is something profound within every human being. That suspicion turns into a marvel when they try to understand the truth, and later on it becomes a realization. By the great sages, which was in the 18th century, the French philosopher and mystic Pascal, who said, "In space, the universe engulfs me and reduces me to a thin point." That's what we are. In spatial terms, who are we? A speck of dust within the immensity of the universe. That's our nature. So the first sentence of this, "In space, the universe engulfs me and reduces me to a thin point. But through thought, I understand that universe." That immensity of the universe I'm able to understand through my thought. What must be my dimension? Am I merely a speck of dust? No. That speck of dust contains a tremendous splendor. That the Atman, the subject of this marvel, mastery of Prashidaya. Some people see it as a wonder. Some people hear it as a wonder. These are the various sections of paper. Bodily, some people speak of it as a wonder. But after hearing, very few really understand what is this wonder. And if you realize it, what a wonderful experience it must be. If this worldly experience is wonderful, million times more wonderful will be that experience. That is the giver which has given the Indian mind for centuries. After the purchase, our people were given by this discovery. I must know this truth. That's why so many people went down the forests and caves, meditations, just to realize this profound truth. But there is no other technology except that none of these physical technologies can help them. And so you find rock caves here, they are all over. And eventually, you produce a Buddha. A man who really penetrated into this model and studied his words as he realized his immortal truth, he was so full of joy. For 7 days or so he was walking up and down under that very tree where he realized the truth. He was full of joy. He expressed it as much as he can through words. Here he finished his verses. So it is something extraordinary. So this verse 29 is expressing that marvel which ordinary people also will feel, extraordinary people also will feel. Ashcharya, Yadaka Ashcharya, man is a wonder, man is a marvel. Don't reduce yourself to dust, don't reduce yourself to a creature of position. Within that there is something wonderful. That is the one truth we must impress upon all our children, that you are not a tiny little baby. Behind you is infinite energy and power. That the first without the teaching for every child. The teaching which the child will realize as true as it grows up and becomes mature. That is one truth, that is central truth, all Vedantic teaching. So, verse 30 tells us, Dehi Nityam Avat Jyoyam, Dehi Sarvasya Bharata, Tasmat Sarvani Bhutani, Natvam Shochitu Matrasi. This Dehi, the self, the human one who lives in the deha, is called the dehi. So deha and dehi. Deha is body, dehi who bears the body. Dehi nityam avat jyoyam. None can destroy the dehi at any time. Fascinated of this infinite truth. Dehi sarvasya bharata. In all bodies, this self of dehi is indestructible. Tasmat sarvani bhutani natvam shochitum arhasi. You did not therefore grieve for any in pity, in being, in this world, we can never touch that real dimension of the human system. Somebody takes away my shirt, I just want to protect me, they can take another shirt. In that way, we speak of material things. But those who know the subject, they say, whatever you may do, the body, my self is untouched. If that is kept intact, then there is nothing to worry. The stronger the person, the more the capacity to express the truth in life and action, greater courage, greater endurance, all this will come. Like that Jewish scientist in Hitler's prison. They are all subjected to tremendous pressure, all sorts of persecution, suffering, creating tension, stress, many things in that kind of treatment. But one survived. And he wrote a book, Victor Frankl. He lives in New York now. The Search of Meaning, that's the title of his book. And there he mentions, I was subjected to so much of pressure, so much of persecution. I would have broken down, but I detached myself from the body, began to think of myself as an option, as a witness of what is going on. I was safe. I could stand all this pressure on me. My mind was perfectly understood and then go on. So I could write this book as a successful experiences. Then he calls it attitude control. You cannot control what others do to you. But you can control your attitude towards those things. That's in your hands. That's a very remarkable statement made by Viktor Frankl, the search for meaning, attitude control. Somebody abuses me, well, he abuses me every day. I do beat him, I nurse him, and take him seriously for me. I don't even commit suicide. Because I am weak. If I am strong, yes, he has said a few words. What he said? All the 26 words in the alphabet, he has put away the rest of something. That way you can say and dismiss the whole thing. That needs a lot of strength. So attitude control is a very great lesson for all of us. Mostly we are our own enemies. We create trouble for ourselves. Others only give us little trouble. We multiply it by ourselves. Their attitude control can save that situation. That it is true. It was true. Viktor Frankl refers to an experience in American war prisons in Italy. One war was full of hiding, but people suffered the army, soldiers. Hand is gone, leg is gone, such type of people. Very much suffering. Then another war, minor injuries in the back. They are under treatment, and serious injuries on one side, and they are also under treatment. An investigation showed people who had serious injuries, they were more peaceful, more cooperative, and in this less injured people you found so much of complaint, stress, no peace of mind, there's something strange. How could it be? These people should have been much more in distress than these people. Then they found on investigation that power of attitude. In the case of this less injured people, there were people who will be soon treated, set right, and they know they will be sent to the front once again. In this war, they knew the war is over. They will go back to their wife and children. They were perfectly at peace. The leg is gone in the matter. We shall leave it to our people. Now here you can see two situations, two reactions to various situations. So it proves the idea of attitude control. So that book gives you this tool, which only brings the great tools that you find mentioned here. Aschere Yuvat Pashere Aschere Nena. If he understood a little bit of this truth, he got tremendous strength out of it. He had that calmness of mind. He would write a book to enlighten other people. Otherwise, they would have been completely destroyed by the treatment. So these are the tools. Man standing in marvel towards looking at that man. There is something wonderful in that human being. In me also, the same wonderful thing is there. Let us try a reason in the course of our work, in the course of our day-to-day relationship. Let us study this subject religion and come closer to that marvel that is our creation. That is what the Gita tells. And the Gita especially stresses that this marvel can be realized in the context of man's life, work, and interhuman relations. We did not have a separate life for it. Life itself is religion, as they have said. Because that religion, which is the spirituality, is my own nature. I am not to borrow somebody from somebody. So this concept of the inherent divinity of man, its infinite nature, is at the back of Krishna's teaching. Throughout his book hereafter, this first part of the second chapter, he is using these arguments to tell Arjuna, when you are afraid of entering into this world, entering into the garden, you are under ascetic, you have got so many things to do here. All this is being argued about to make Arjuna take part in the Lord in front. Many more worldly arguments will come later. When he found these arguments to conflict with Arjuna, he used worldly arguments also that they are coming in the next few verses. Not from Shyamala Maharaji, he did not grieve over these people, saying they are wicked, their own true nature is beyond anybody's destruction. Just like space, we cannot destroy space. We can destroy everything, we cannot destroy space. Similarly, is this the more subtle the reality, the more beyond destruction, as well as birth, is that reality. Here we have the subtlest reality, the Atman or Brahman. Then he says now, you are a Kshatriya. Saranamapityavekshya. Navikam pitumadvasi. Arnyaki rachayavanya Kshatriyasya na vidyate. Even from the point of view of your own dharma, you should not recoil from this challenge before you. So dharmyam. Then, for a Kshatriya, a law which is righteous, it is a very dangerous proposition. Any one man is righteous. Not 3 days ago, I had occasion to say that the law against Nazi movement in Germany was a righteous law. The whole world would have been completely distorted if that power has won the battle. So the whole world joined together to fight against that pernicious doctrine which destroyed millions and millions of people. Occasionally, such occasions of war will come. Not every war is not righteous war. Yes, for aggression, that's no real war at all. But suppose an army invades your country, they are going to lose your freedom. You have the right to preserve your freedom. That is certainly a very righteous war. On the contrary, if you don't do it, you will pay for it and your generations will pay for it. Therefore, the word Sodhanma Kapiya Abhayakshya. Sodhanma, that is Sodhanma. The Kshatriya has to protect the freedom of the people. Serve them, as a nature of it, Kshatriya. Today we have the old concept in a new situation. The old Kshatriya today is a politician and the administrator. What is his work? His work is to protect the people, nourish the people, serve the people. Somebody has to do it in the political administrative system that do this thing. That is their duty. So Kshatriya is on one side politics administration. The other side defense. That's also Kshatriya's duty. He has to protect the people. You are a policeman. You are sleeping at night. The police protect you from being robbed. the operative unit. Succeeded in it. So they now walk also at night. That shows our society has become thoroughly demoralized. But the truth is, we can see streets only because law is there outside to protect you. There is nature of law, law well established, constitutional, society and state, that the purpose. So in this way, the politician, the administration, and all the different services, including civil defense services like the police, they belong to the Kshatriya class. Their work is to serve others with their power, with their energy. They handle power, but the power is for the service of people, that is the nature of their power. So when Yudhishthira wanted to renounce the kingdom after war, Bhishma told him, this is a very interesting sentence, Mahabharata, Charitamrita. Dandaye kari rajendra chaturdharmo na mundanam. O Yudhishthira, the duty of a kshatriya is dandaye, means exercise of power to serve the people, and not mundanam, shaving the head is becoming an ascetic. Mundanam means becoming an ascetic. That's not your business. Your business is here. The world has been divided in this way. By choice, you prove to be a kshatriya. Therefore, do your duty. So that is Krishna is telling, Dharmyati Uttam Sayodhyat. A kshatriya is happy to fight a war which has a great cause to inspire it. A human liberation war, for example. That's beautiful. And we are happy to participate in it, etc. But we can claim every war as dharmya. That is not accepted. At least you still condemn some wars. You are probably dharmya, but was not dharmya in later kind of study. So also, this one is perfectly dharmya. To protect your national freedom. A defensive war is always dharmya. Offensive wars, some are not. Very few are. Most are not. But defensive war, to protect your freedom, protect your family, your interest, all that is perfectly legitimate, and is a duty. If you don't do so, you have forsaken your duty according to the Sanatana Dharma tradition. Dharmya Kirtha Kshayaranya Kshatriyasya Harindade. Kshatriya is very happy whenever he gets an opportunity to fight for a noble cause, to serve the people, to protect the people, just like you have sent some soldiers now and public officers to monitor the peace between Iran and Iraq. That's a wonderful experience. Like our army went to Congo, our army went to Korea for peace evening. These are all very good examples where you are there not for aggression, not for gaining some property or land for yourself, but to establish a peace that was spoken earlier. So all these arguments are included in this particular statement. Dharmya Kiyutna Chayodhya Kshatriya Sanamitya. No better opportunity for Kshatriya to exercise his intelligence, his ability, his love for man than to take part in a battle to establish human values, establish freedom, dignity, and the universality of the individual person. Then in this case, the next verse says, Yadutraya Chopanam Svakratvara Makarvan Sugina Kshatriya Partha Yadante Yudhan Yudhishan. This war is Yadutraya Chopanam. We didn't seek it. It has come by itself, Yadutshya, by chance it has come. We can see it. Yadutshya Chopamanyam. Svagratvaya Apavadam. The doors are heaven are open. Doors are heaven here means light of glory. When you fight in such a garden, you get a sense of glory. Svagratvaya Apavadam. Sukhina Kshatriya Apavadam. Yadande Yudha Midrashi. The Kshatriya is happy. If he gets such opportunities to exercise his military talent, other aspects he won't like, army to satisfy that they are employed in stopping civil disturbances. 3 months old people, they are not happy at all. And no nation should do it more than a few limited times. To do more often, you spoil the whole situation. Because there is no legitimacy in that. So in this case, they did want the war, they want to avoid it, they did everything possible, and yet finally these people became so intolerant of any compromise, they had to get into this mess called war. Really, nobody accepts war as a necessity. The world Mahabharata, of the Gita is a part. Always try to avoid war, always try to avoid conflict, try to seek peace always, that's correct, that is correct, repeat it again and again. But under whatever circumstances, don't recoil from the duty that is before you. That also is added here and there. A warlike attitude is not there, a warlike philosophy is not there, but war is there. Because of the disparity, the human situation. Just like a criminal comes, loots your house, you have to protect yourself against him. If you don't do so, you and your children all will suffer. Therefore, there is need to self-protection and any activity which enforces that self-protection. In that sense only, war is used in the Mahabharata context. The book is spiritual, and the greatest hero there, the Yudhishthira, a man of peace, no hatred to anybody. His name also very interesting. Vyasatru was the name of Yudhishthira, who the lineage yet to be born. With that nature, a man like Yudhishthira. So, his brothers were of this nature, and Krishna is also advising them. Forsake war. Like that. So if you study the totality of Mahabharata, you will never find there's a book of war. But war is developing. Human nature has become corrupt in many big ways. Arrogance and pride, all these things came. So you can see various incidents leading up to the Kurukshetra. That's it. There was no possibility of sending it earlier. When the Mahabharata senior will come in the Durdarshan, you will see the story developing in small ways, developing into the biggest war that we had in ancient times, which really destroyed so much of our humanity and our culture. This is a different theory of Mahabharata war is a big turning point in the history of our own country. So, this is Yadukshaya Prabhupadanyam. Svartatvaya Kapavutam. Sugiran Shatriya Pavakta. Yadante Yudha Nidashi. Then he says, if you don't do so, Apachetvam Imam Parnyam Sankramam Nalaishyasi. If you don't face this battle now, Kadina, what happens to you? Tata Sudharmam Kirtinja Ketva Hitva. You will destroy your own dharma and your own great name, your good name. Guilty. It was Papam Vapsati. You will incur sin. You have second your duty, your great name also you have destroyed. Making the next yoga to say, people will call you a coward and all these things. Agarikna Chapi, Gokani, Padayashani Te, Padaya, Pambhavidasa Chapi, Marana, Agarikshade. Other people, we are also speaking of him. He will be a product of any good from other people. Agirthin Chavi Bhutani, Padayashin Dete Agriyam, lasting his honor. So, Arjuna was a coward, he ran away from where all these talks will go on. That will be your share later on. And one who has already got a great place of honor, to lose that honor is worse than death itself. That is a wonderful statement. You get it in the English, death before dishonor, the English statement. But it's exactly what we have in the Mahabharata. Sambhavita Sachapirvin Marana Padavichade. Man with good name and honor he gives dishonor. It is written that is just death is better than living dishonor. That is a wonderful idea. All the heroic people think that way. Death is preferable to living dishonor, infamy, etc. Many people today do not understand this one. The sense of honor is going down and down. I'm afraid even for all dishonor, but I want money, that is. Don't touch that. And I don't mind any more than abuse. So we have not the sense of honor. But money plays a greater part in life, honor becomes less and less. People want honor, really. Great people want honor. And not mere money. The abuse of them, he cannot bear it. It is very bad. They abuse somebody else. All his honor is on their right. If he is mad of honor, only he will feel it. Otherwise, he isn't here. He didn't say anything. I will go my own way. Not philosophically, but because they are interested in something else. How to enjoy this money, how to get maximum of it, like I did it. I gave the example of Sri Ramdas, who saw the driving debt and insolvency. For the poverty. And he had become a lawyer. First case, he got the money. See what he did at that time. The first thing he did with that money was go to the court, take the father's name from that dishonor of what he called for stealing all his not paying his dues, etc. And then he restored his father's honor. That's what he did. There's no need for him to do, you can say. But he wanted the honor of his father to be restored. What kind of glory it is. So money is secondary. Honor is primary. That doesn't we have to learn now in a new way. We have lost it for the last few decades. So the Bhagavad Gita Chakra, Marana Patanichari, worse than death, is dishonor. For those who are already holding an honorary position, people do not mind their form, losing all their honor. Still, they go to society as if they are big people, and others also clap their hands, seeing them go to see them even. Just like when a man commits a big murder, he all like to go see him. He becomes the center. He will write a book and make a million rupees also with the book. That's our taste in society. So, this sentence is very important. If you have a sense of honor, try to protect it. Honor is greater. So, Krishna is telling Arjuna this idea. Other criticisms people will tell about you. Bhaya, Vima, Lopadam. Some Mamsyante, Vam, Mahayata. Great heroes will consider Arjuna. And run away from battle out of fear, bhaya. They were all sitting there. Yesham chattvam bhavato bhutva vyasyati lāgava. Till now, they all spoke highly of you. They respected your hari, etc. And now onwards, they will speak ill of you. It's a coward, he is a coward. But can be more unhappy than that situation. Krishna is telling Arjuna. Yesham chattvam bhavato bhutva, by whom you are honored till now, vyasyati lāgavam, in their eyes you will become small, petty, a little covered, etc. Abhachya vallam shiva bhuvan, vadishyante tava aitara, nindandrastava samadhyam, tato dukkataram dukhim. Then it is, they will speak all the sorts of words against you, which is not fit to even hear. It will burn your mind to hear those words. Such burning words they will speak against you. Avachya Vadam Shivabhun. Varishyandi Dava Ahira, your enemies. Vambhavya. Then, Nindandrasva Samakhyam. They will deny your capacities and talents. Taro Lukkadara Mugim. That can be more unhappy, sorrow creating than this situation. You want to have all this? Never going for it. You have this cowardice. Face up to your problem. Is Krishna's advice to Arjuna. And so, summing up this whole section, making Arjuna face up to the situation, Krishna is concluding in verse 37. This is the appeal to those who believe in the world and the high world like a heaven, where you can enjoy nicely. To all such people, this kind of appeal is made. Atova Rapsasi Sotram Jitvava Mokshase Mokshase Mahi Tasmad Uttrishta Kaunteya Vidhaya Kutanishchaya. That is the last verse in this section. First way in Arjuna. What did he say? Atova Rapsasi Sotram. Suppose you are filled with Arjuna, you will get Vela Sotram. The heroic heaven, heaven meant for heroes. Today, how much you remember the famous Rajput rulers who faced modern battles and gave up their life with honor and dignity? We remember them, we honor them even today. So, he is telling, Bhagavan, Ramsasi, Sultan, Jitwa, Bhokshasi, Mahi. But suppose you win the life, you also enjoy dominion in this world. So, either way, you are a loser. That's the appeal to all heroic sentiments in man. Tasmad Uttishta Kaunteya. Therefore, stand up, Arjuna. The son of Kunti, Kaunteya, the son of Kunti. You try it, Uttanishtaya. Fully determined to face up to the war situation with your son. I shall not run away. I shall face up to this problem. With that determination, stand up, stand up. As I said at the beginning, when I was reading the first chapter, Arjuna had a real war to face. You and I do not have real wars to face. But the real teaching is related to all of us. Because the nature of war for you and me is day-to-day problems. You have to face them. You have to overcome them. Someone has energy from within to face up to all this. That is the philosophy given to one becomes universal in application. Whether you are here or people in America or Europe, so they appreciate China, anywhere, the philosophy remains the same. It is not be always only for a man who has achieved to get somebody in a battle, not at all. So from now onwards, you are taking a particular instance, putting it in a universal context. A profound philosophy of life and action is being accorded hereafter. His intention was to make Arjuna face up to the battle situation. But his intention with respect to you and me is to make us manly and strong and face up to the life challenges. Man must show that he is a master of the environment. He should not become a creature of the environment. To restore man to that dignity, you need a philosophy. That is the philosophy Krishna is going to expound throughout this book. It is a philosophy of life, very practical. That's why we will call it now, the next few verses, Yoga. I am teaching you Yoga. If I say Yoga nearly, we only remember Pranayama or chanting on the head and all these things. Nothing of that here. It is a practical philosophy of life. How to handle this wonderful human situation by which you develop your own spiritual consciousness within and you become instrumental to happiness and welfare of people around you. That is the philosophy of life and a comprehensive spirituality that Krishna is expounding. Calling it by the strong word Yoga. You will come to it immediately a few verses later. So here he said, Tasmad Uttishta Kaunteya Yudhaya Kutanishtaya. Therefore stand up. Krishna only speaks this word. Stand up. Don't lie down. Don't be lazy. Don't be cozy. That kind of thing. Be alert. Be energetic. Be active. Buddha also said, always be alert. Don't be cozy, lazy. There's a tendency for us to be cozy and lazy. That should not be. So in the Vedanta you find this Uttishtada Vyagrata, the constant refrain, arise away, our tendency is to sleep, our tendency is to withdraw ourselves into advices. No, life is for the hard working people, not for the weak, not for the sleepy. That message comes again and again, like the famous verse, popular verse coming from ancient times. Udyamena hisithyanti karyani na anuvadakaiti. Mahesuttasya simhasya prashyanti mukhe udaha. It is to udyama, hard work, industrious activities that you achieve things in this world. Udyamena hisithyanti karyani. Not by daydreaming, simply imagining that you should do this, you should do this, that mano, rata is called. Carry your mind as a rata, as a chariot, and fly it over the air. That is not the way. Uttyamena hisithyanti karyani na anuvadakaiti. Then the example is given. A sigma, that's completely old, he stopped pursuing his prey. So he will always lie down with a wide open mouth. I'm sure some animal will bite me by entering into my mouth, then I will have my food. That's the lion will not get any food at all. Nahi, suttasya simhasya prashyanti mukhe mruda. Mruda means deer. Deers are not going to bite the simha. He has kept his mouth open, let me enter into him. He will never do so. You have to work hard to get your food for the day. So that is the example given in that verse. Similarly, Krishna is telling here. Now from verse 38, you hear new music. That music is the original music of Krishna's philosophy, philosophy of life. From the ancient Upanishads, same teaching is heard all the time. But from those very teachings, he finds a new teaching, a new philosophy of life, and then he taught it from this 38 verse onwards. Practical Vedanta. Ego Vedanta is true, and infinite Atman, same Atman as in all beings. If these are true, what follows? How will they affect your life and my life? That is it. Practical Vedanta that Krishna is bringing out in the remaining verses of this great book. The 14th shloka is this, verse 38. What does he say? Sugadukhe sametutva labhalabhau yadayam prabhuvithai yudhyasva nayam papam avapsyati avapsyati. Keep your mind even. Not sight and up and down. Keep your mind even. So the way in happiness and misery. Lama Lapo. In profit as well as loss. Yadayam. Victory or defeat. In all these various changing situations, try to keep the mind as calm as possible. Tapo Yuktaya Yasva. With such a mind, enter this battlefield of life, then you will never suffer. You will succeed. Paramam Vapsati. You will never have incurring sin if you have this attitude. This concept of calmness of mind is a wonderful concept. Whenever you want to achieve great things, it's not through excitement that we achieve. The calm, silent, steady work, you achieve great things. And so, in today's politics, it's all excitement. We want to excite the whole people, and excitement dies down also after some time. But those who are great workers, they are not of that nature. They have tremendous convictions. They are calm and steady. They work. They face problems. They overcome them, keeping their mind calm and steady. He's a calm and steady man that does most of the work. The excited man shows his working, but there is little work turned out. There is not believe in what I call going out doing good. But when you watch closely, it is not going about that doing good. So much of excitement, so much of noise, and not so little what is being done. There are plenty of such in our society today. But calm, silent, steady work is real work. That is the work Krishna is studying now. A housewife is a price of her. Administrator is a price to him. So also, any professional is a price to him. Calm, silent, steady work. Can you balance your mind, make it calm and steady? Its tendency is to go up and down. In fact, that's the big psychology in itself. Every experience of the external world throws the mind into waves. Just like putting a stone in a lake, one place running. The mind is like that. Every experience turns the mind into waves. Some experiences make for bigger waves, and some become extremely atlantic waves. That's not bad. You have thrown off your ground. You lose your mental balance thereby. So most of us have some measure of balance in the midst of day-to-day life, except when something extraordinary happens to us. But by training, we can increase our capacity to keep the mind steady when unsteady influences work on it. That's what Krishna is introducing now. Because he is giving you a philosophy of life and work. And life and work means upsetting off in the mind. So you must handle the mind. You must keep it calm and steady. With the beginning of the teaching, you will later on define his philosophy itself as samatvam. Yoga uchate. Yoga is samatvam. This mind is calm and steady. That is yoga. Not only is not. Take any animal. Any experience coming to the animal throws his mind into a tremendous conversion. Then he must find immediate expression in action. Then he dies away. That's the nature of animal behavior. But in the case of man also, when they have not started playing houses, when they offer disease behavior, when you are primitive, you are doing like this, though even then, a certain darkness had come to the human system because nature had provided for it that every sensory input will be observed, then passed on as a motor output. A little gap between input and output, even the most ordinary man had. That's the beginning of a tremendous development in the human psyche. It just negated the beginning of that development, that put a little stop between input and output. Suppose somebody abused me. Immediately I abuse back. Don't do so. That means you are an animal. Or an animal, as we say. Somebody put and you return it back. And always we say action and reaction are equal and opposite. That's a mechanical law. But the case of man, he can alter it. If the action is one unit, the action can be 10 units also. Or it can be no unit also. That shows you are free. There is no other definition of freedom. You are not a creature of some external circumstance. You regulate your reaction. As soon as you start regulating your reaction, you have achieved your manhood, your humanity. That march is tremendous. You are handling your mind. You are creating a tremendous sense of calmness there. Then great achievements will come thereby. Human evolution begins with the achievement of this balancing of the mind between a sensory input and a motor output. That must be strengthened more and more, more and more. We shall come across this subject again and again because the whole subject is training this human mind to handle this world around it and handle itself in a masterly way. We don't become a creature of some masterly forces outside. We are the masterly force handling our life. This must be achieved by the human being and our physiology today, we're jealous that nature has endowed the human being with that organic capacity to handle his life on this masterly planet. He is not a man, a mere creature. He can be free, he can be free. So this teaching of modern biology, neurology, and the ancient Vedanta, they go together. So far as man is concerned, Vedanta takes it to the highest level of development. This wonderful thought of initial human freedom to put a gap between input and output of experience. That's the beginning. Out of that river, a wonderful achievement. Towards the end of this chapter, of responding to the philosophy, Krishna will give you in about 18 or 19 verses the nature of that human mind which has achieved perfect equilibrium, perfect steadiness. It's called Sthita Pratnya, that wonderful word. Sthita Pratnya. Pratnya means knowledge or vision. Sthita, steady. How is it? Vision is not steady. It comes and goes. But by training, you can make the mind steady. Wisdom, steady. Those verses are masterly verses. The end of the second chapter. First, the exposition. Then, an illustration. That type of character we must have in ourselves. But the whole subject is meant for every citizen, every human being, man, woman, and child. How to realize this human individuality? How to handle this magic of psychophysical energy we have got at birth? How to develop it, expand it, bring out the best out of it? Who has to do it? Yourself? Each one has to do. Others can help, but the actual work is your own. So, Vedanta repeatedly stresses this point, building up your life and character is your own work, your own privilege. Don't deal with others. Take help from anybody, but the work is your own. And when you develop, Lord with marvel, yes, there is one who is a given capital of psychic energy. Yes, we can do all the business of intellectual, spiritual life. Yes, like any businessman starting with 1,000 rupees capital, they can become self-reliant. Because he doesn't get properly, work hard, etc. The same thing in the case of human personality, how are you to do that? On the given capital, a great personality, which is a great blessing to oneself and the world outside. That's a gift. Will come now, and hereafter is all this subject. And the references to oneself, though it's told to Arjuna, Krishna tells it to everyone. What should I do with my faculty of psychic energy? Okay. Industry and commerce, we are seeing a new type of entrepreneurship in India. People are generally lazy, cozy, like before. Freedom has got a sense of one's own importance and has new energy to work hard. So a few months ago, in the India Today, they have published a big dispatch, the new entrepreneurs in India. I'm very inspired. Article I found. A man has only 1,000 rupees. He invested, works hard, builds up, now he has become a big industrialist. Like that, hundreds of cases, India is showing this initiative, this enterprise, no more are we. Even to this much idea, this might be to be like this, that philosophy is going away. The real philosophy is coming. Only additions will come. When they read the Gita, these hundreds of new entrepreneurs, if they study the Gita, they will take this aspect of entrepreneurship, initiative, along with it, infinite compassion for man. All this that I learn, they express my personality, I develop resources, I will spend it for the good of all, for the good of society. That second blessing will come to those entrepreneurs when they get the Gita message, along with their own tremendous energy and enterprise. Enterprise is beautiful. When I was a student in the high school, I read a small book, a statement from my colleague and his own teacher, Mill. Says, it is always advisable to be in the forefront of opportunity in matters of enterprise and in backing of opportunity in matters of indulgence. For pleasure, you are in the back. For enterprise, you are in front. That's why there is going to be cooked and there. There is time for eating, that has time. And there. Some people come only with the vegetables. Some people are ready to do the cooking. That this one is far better than the other one. In matters of enterprise, be forefront. Matters of intelligence, be far behind. Then this is your children. Then we shall develop this nation in the highest level of character. That person is not. We are teaching all our children. Be forefront in time of pressure and profit. Enterprise, if it is personal, you do. If it is for the nation, don't do anything. Keep quiet. That is the teaching we are giving, ruining the character of our children. So let us take from this great book that wonderful new orientation we have given to education in name, namely human social development, value-oriented education. The Gita is full of these ideas, value-oriented education and human resource development. So carrying this message to the society, to the children, to students everywhere, we shall continue this topic. Especially now, we are getting to the heart of Gita's message in the middle of this second chapter. Next Sunday, when we meet here, in between, there is this Janmashtami on the 3rd, the Saturday. Swami Shivananda speaks in Telugu this Saturday. So I request him to speak on Sri Krishna, his birth and his teachings on 3rd from 6 to 7. And 7 to 9, we will have worship of Sri Krishna in the temple. And Bali and everybody do Pushpanjali Patram at the end of the worship. That's the program for the 3rd. But we shall meet for the Sunday lecture next Sunday as usual. We will spend a minute in silence and then there will be Arati in the temple. Those who like may attend it and then we can disperse. వసుదేవస్కందేవం వంశకామోదమర్దనం దేవకీ కర్మానందం కృష్ణం వందే జగద్గురుం. వి సల్యూట్ శ్రీకృష్ణ ప్రసన్న వసుదేవ అండ్ ది బిలీవర్ ఆఫ్ దేవకి డిస్ట్రాయర్ ఆఫ్ ఈవిల్ ఫోర్సెస్ హు ఇస్ ది సుప్రీం టీచర్ ఆఫ్ ద హోల్ వరల్డ్ ప్రివెంట్ ది ఆఫర్